Coming up on Thunder Insider, after opening the Western Conference Finals in San Antonio, the series now shifts to OKC. We'll take a look back at games 1 and 2 and break down the keys for the Thunder on their home floor. Plus, a number of Thunder fans descended on the Alamo City. We caught up with some of the Thunder faithful as they cheered on Big Blue. Got all that, and Steely goes one-on-one with NBA superfan Jimmy Goldstein as Thunder Insider gets started right now.
Where do I go to get this look?
Hello and welcome everyone to Thunder Insider presented by Integris Health. I'm Kelly Kroll, your host, alongside 15-year NBA veteran and Thunder analyst Grant Long, coming to you from inside our Oklahoman studio. The Thunder and Spurs, of course, opened the Western Conference Finals in San Antonio, and the Spurs, Grant, have held serve on their home floor. But the Thunder was right there in Game 1, and in Game 2, we saw them really show some incredible fight there at the end of the game. Just your thoughts now that this series shifts to Oklahoma City.
Well, I feel a sense of obligation now to talk the fans off the ledge, so to speak, though those people in Thunder Nation who feel like we're down 0-2 and all is wrong with the world. But let me assure you that this is not a surprise to anybody. If you think back on the last two series for the Thunder, they had the home court advantage, and they did win their home court game. So it's not a mystery, or it's not a surprise that the San Antonio Spurs, as well as they play, won their two home games. Now the Thunder have an opportunity on their home floor to take care of business and, you know, have an opportunity to tie the series up.
So settle down a little bit.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Big picture, basically there's still a lot of basketball to be played in this series. Each of these teams know it's the first to four to move on. And when we look back at games 1 and 2, you'll understand why that still leaves a lot of interesting minutes in front of us.
These were the two best in the West throughout the regular season. This best of seven showdown for a spot in the NBA Finals should be something else. Parker right of the lane goes up. Westbrook blocked the 17-footer. Russell a loose ball up the middle, 3-on-2. Down the lane to the rim. Scoops and scores, and what a smothering effort by Westbrook. Harden behind a Collison pick, crosses over, down the lane, darts, takes it up in traffic, loses. Collison grabs it out of midair and thumps it down with a two-hand ferocious clutch. Ginobili arcs a three-angle left, feeling it, and he drains another. He's got 10. Oklahoma City's got to find a way to shut down that smoking gun. Puts a bounce pass low to Perkins, who dunks! He rose up and thundered down the right-hand sledgehammer over Diaw. That was a beauty. I'll tell you what, Kevin Durant and this team are just fearless attacking in the open floor. Their length and activity shutting the Spurs out from the field in this third quarter. 0-4 start. The question becomes, and it was going into this series, can the Thunder stop the Spurs' potent offense with a game in the balance? That's exactly the case in Game 1 of the Western Finals. San Antonio 101, Oklahoma City 98. They grabbed a one-game-to-none Western Conference Finals lead against the Thunder. Well, it's said you never get a second chance to make a first impression, but the Thunder do have a second chance to gain the desired split of the opening two games of this Western Conference Final. Out front, Harden off the pump fake. Guidance Durant open. Wing left three on the way. Ching, a Thunder money ball. Great find by Harden. Leonard had the rebound tipped away from him by Cephalosha. Westbrook long leads Durant, galloping to the rim. He whirly birds down the right-hand sledgehammer in transition. This defensive unit for the Thunder really lacking, Grant. They're a step behind. And the Thunder still cannot get a handle on this elusive San Antonio half-court offense. Ibaka digs it out along the sideline to Harden, driving right away from Splitter down the lane, scoops and scores and gets a bang for his bucket. Pulls up on the wing, lobs in the lane. The ball stripped from Duncan by Ibaka up the middle. Westbrook, 3-on-2. Bounce pass out in front, Durant for the right-hand dunk. 7-point game with 1:52 left. Spurs hold serve at home in the first two. And the San Antonio Spurs' perfect run in the playoffs continues. They're up 2-0 in the Western Conference Finals.
So the best in the West still to be determined in this series between the Thunder and the Spurs. Oklahoma City trailing now 2-0. But the thing is, Grant, they've done a lot of things really well. And as Coach Brooks will tell us throughout the series, he will point out to his guys, he feels like it's just as important to show them, when he shows them the mistakes and the adjustments they can make, to also show them the things that they have done really well to this point that they can carry on throughout the series.
I love the fact that the pace of this game favors the Oklahoma City Thunder. They're up and down in transition. They're getting stops, mm-hmm. and they're running and getting easy baskets. That's a paramount importance in the playoffs, to get easy baskets. It doesn't come very easily, but the Thunder team to be able to get out and transition off the Spurs, and that's something that can be a component to success for them. Now, they've got to continue to get stops in the half court. The Spurs are very good when they buckle down and play and execute their half court offense. I just say they have terrific ball movement that will spread out the defense, and all of a sudden they get wide open jump shots, and that's something that Scott Brooks will have to address in the upcoming practice.
26 fast break points, as you said, in game two. In game one, well, also in game two, if you will, they also got to the free throw line, being very aggressive, attacking the basket, just that continuing throughout these next couple of games, how important that will be. And they have their home crowd behind them, so certainly they'll be able to feed off that energy and keep things going.
You mentioned the free throws, and so important about the free throws are the guys that are getting to the free throw line, the key guys. Durant getting there. Harden is a big part of Harden's success is getting to the free throw line. He got there double-digit attempts in game two. That has to continue also. I think they found a niche with Harden in game two. He was able to come off that screen and roll and get into the lane, create some contact with the Spurs, and get to the free throw line. That has to continue with a high level of efficiency as well.
Well, now, as we mentioned, the series does shift to Oklahoma City, so the Thunder will have their home crowd. And, Grant, do you feel like they've seen just about everything the Spurs have to offer at this point? And if so, what are the keys to turning things around in games three and four?
Well, first of all, I think the biggest adversity that this team has faced so far in the playoffs is starting off on the road. They haven't had to do that. They've had to now be the team that has to make the adjustments. Before this, they were the team forcing everybody else to make adjustments. Mm-hmm. Now they have to make the adjustments down 0-2. But I think that's not a bad position to be in when you have a young group of guys who are very receptive to constructive criticism. So Scott Brooks and his staff will put together a game plan. And I'm sure the way these guys are going to come out in game three with a lot of energy, the building will be on fire, so to speak. And these guys will really step up and play their best basketball. I look for them to even run more than they did in games one and two because of the energy in the building. The defense is going to pick up. They're going to have a presence in the passing lane. That's always important. And you're going to see guys rebound, get those long outlet passes to Russell, Durant. These guys are really going to push the tempo of this ball game.
When you talk about defense, one of the things we heard after game one especially was needing to play a full 48 minutes of defense. And even the pick and roll is something that they've talked about. They feel like they've gotten a little bit better in that area in just the first couple games. Do you think they found something by going a little smaller in that last quarter of game two and switching on screens?
Well, when you go smaller, you have that advantage of switching on the screens, but you also have an advantage because you're quicker and you can get to the Spurs outside shooters. The one thing the Spurs do very well that other teams don't do, when they get into the pick and roll, they'll pass to the roll guy, but if he's not open, they'll find their spacing on the perimeter and they'll hit that guy as well. So you have a decision to make defensively, whether you're going to pick up Tim Duncan rolling to the basket for a high percentage shot, or you're going to force the ball to the outside and then rotate there. That's something that the Thunder will have to buckle down in these next two couple of days of practices and try to hone in on that. But I think the Spurs, again, making that extra pass makes it difficult. But when Scott Brooks goes to the smaller lineup, he adds that quickness to be able to get out to the perimeter and challenge those shots a little quicker.
There's a reason why the Spurs had the best record in the West. Certainly defensively, they make things tough for so many teams. And as Coach Brooks said, they are the best passing team in the league.
Ahead on Thunder Insider.
Still ahead on Thunder Insider, former coach of the day, Lorelei Decker, continued her scouting in San Antone.
I've never been on a road game for the Thunder ever, and it's weird. It's being here because it's not my normal routine and everything, but we're well represented.
We get her thoughts on the trip and hear from the flyaway winners when we come back.
Welcome back to Thunder Insider.
The Thunder hoping to get back on track in the Western Finals as they host the next couple games at home. And joining us now from the Thunder's practice facility is Brian Davis and Matt Pinto with more on what to expect as this series unfolds, guys.
Well, if you take a look, Kelly, at the first two games in San Antonio, the Thunder played three brilliant quarters of defensive basketball and then let things slide away in the fourth quarter. Game two, lots of opportunities inside, which is what Scott Brooks wanted, Matt, but the Thunder didn't shoot well and wound up falling way behind, having to scramble back out of that.
The one thing that's noticeable two games in, Brian, to me, is that lack of shooting effectively, lack of scoring inside is affecting this team's defense. And you cannot do that against a team the caliber of the San Antonio Spurs, especially with how honed they are and how razor sharp they are on the offensive end. So the Thunder have got to recognize that if they can somehow, regardless of what goes on at one end of the floor, not allow it to affect the other end and get back to playing their game with their identity in a sustained way, they give themselves a chance in this series.
We have to play with maximum effort every possession, and the entire possession. And if you don't do that, you know, you give them so many open looks because they're the best passing team in the game. They don't hesitate. They make the plays for each other, and they make them consistently, and they make them quickly and on time. But with that being said, you can have great defense, and they still make some tough shots.
You know, just talking about focusing on tomorrow's game, you know, not carrying the past, not worrying about the future. It's really just about tomorrow's game and giving ourselves a chance to win on our home court.
We had a great opportunity game one, you know, losing in the fourth quarter. And then game two, playing well, and then, you know, them having that big lead of 20, then us fighting back and playing Thunder basketball and cutting it to six with, I think, 6 minutes to go, and then just not having enough energy. So we can't, you know, let them get big leads like that.
We have to figure out ways to make it a fourth quarter game like we did in game one, and we have enough guys to do that. We just have to do it consistently for 48 minutes and every second of every shot clock. We're a physical team. We have to play that way. If we play free-flowing basketball, we can beat some teams, but we're not at our best if we're not being physical on the defensive end. Even on offense, we're a physical team. We're aggressive. We set great screens. We set up our screens and we attack the basket. We have dribble penetration. We're looking for extra shooters. That's when we're at our best, and we have to do them both tomorrow night.
We had spurts where we played, you know, very good basketball, and then we had spurts where the ball just stopped on offense, and then on defense, you know, they gave them easy layups and easy three-pointers, and that's how they go on their run. So we just have to play better, you know, throughout the entire game. You know, they don't stop, so we can't either.
As we close today, one of the things we talked about was just that, you know, you can talk about X's and O's and, you know, adjustments and rotations and all those things. But at the end of the day, sometimes it's just, you know, you just have to want it.
All of which, Matt, brings me back to what Scott Brooks has been talking about, which is the team that plays 48 complete minutes, the most complete game of basketball at both ends. That's the team that's going to come out of this thing.
You've almost got to insulate yourself and not allow human nature to take hold. In other words, don't play urgent when you're down 7 in the third quarter or down 22, for example, in game 2, but bring it from the start, sustain it for the full 24 seconds on every possession, and do it at both ends of the floor. Sounds somewhat trite and cliche, but that's really what it's going to take for this team to work its way back into the series and make it competitive to the finish. Kelly?
Thanks a lot, guys. We appreciate you joining us from the road. All season, the Thunder faithful traveled far beyond the Oklahoma limits to represent Big Blue, and the Western Finals were no different. Oklahoma City gear was spotted all over the Alamo City, and once inside the AT&T Center, the number of fans representing OKC just continued to grow.
She got to coach the Thunder on the 24th of April for an entire day and just developed some really great relationships with the coaches.
I think I knew like 5 days ago that I was coming, and so we tried to book a hotel as soon as we could. We were afraid that we wouldn't get one because it was Memorial Day, but we got one, and I was freaking out.
Probably the biggest Thunder fan in this battle she's got with cancer. It has the opportunity to get her down quite a bit, but looking forward to Thunder games, it's just been like the highlight. It's what gets her through all of the tough days. And when we found out there was a chance we could come to this game, she jumped on it. It's like the senior trip she never got to have because she was hooked up to chemo back when everybody else went on a senior trip.
I had never been on a road game for the Thunder ever, and it's weird. It's being here because it's not my normal routine and everything, but we're well represented.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I'm here with the active-duty military, just got back from Afghanistan, and we wanted to come to this game.
Actually, I just came down to visit my buddy. He's got back from Afghanistan, and I just thought I'd come down and give him support while he's down here with his training, and thought we'd hit up a Thunder game.
I've seen about 100 people just at the military installations wearing all kinds of Thunder stuff this whole week. And the past games, I've come to some of these games here just to check out, because I figured these two were playing, so I still even when the Thunder's not here playing, I still see Thunder jerseys in this stadium. So.
I'm from Anchorage, Alaska. I'm down here stationed with the military. Down here supporting the Thunder now.
And being here this close to this kind of action, Western Conference Finals, probably one of the hottest here.
We don't get to go to like many big sporting events up in Alaska.
The young team coming up, I'd love to see the, you know, you talk about the young and old, you know, everybody's talking about it. I love to see the young guys coming beating up the old guys all day long. It's what's going to happen tonight.
Wonderful. This is so exciting. We love it. And you know, it's actually a pretty neat environment. I don't think they're as wonderful as Oklahoma City fans are, but they've been kind.
Ahead on Thunder Insider.
And I would encourage everyone to go on the website because, again, I never thought that I would win, but it's fantastic. It's awesome.
I'm Derek Fisher. You're watching Thunder Insider.
The Thunder's flyaway contest sent two more lucky fans on the road this week. Larry Mayfield and Emilio Vargas hopped a flight to San Antonio, courtesy of the Thunder, to see OKC and the Spurs square off in Game 2 of the Western Conference Finals.
I'm in San Antonio right now because I actually just went to the Thunder website and I seen the link to actually go on and apply for the contest, and believe it or not, I won it. I've never won anything ever, so when she called me, I was like, yeah, what do you call me for? I thought for sure she was selling me something.
Going down.
Enjoy the game.
It feels good. You know, he chose me over his wife, which, you know, kind of questions me a little bit, but in the long run, I'm happy to be here and it's been a great time.
It was much, much more than I expected. I honestly thought that we were just going to show up and we were going to get some tickets and kind of be a free-for-all. It was nothing like that. It was fantastic, and I would encourage everyone to go on the website because, again, I never thought that I would win, but it's fantastic. It's awesome. You know, it's awesome. I've never been to another venue like this, and it's just incredible to see the differences between this one and ours. Ours is still better, though. But it's fantastic. We were lucky enough to sit right in front of some more Thunder fans, so we're pretty awesome. Hey, Thunder! Go Thunder!
You know, when he said we're coming, I was like, yeah, okay, whatever. But now that we're here to cheer on the Thunder. It feels great. I'm ready to have a great game and beat some Spurs.
Ahead on Thunder Insider.
Now, if I want to get this look, where do I go to get this look?
Well, you have to go to Italy to find this.
I don't know if I have the budget, but I'd love to go.
Johnny Versace.
I'm Thabo Sefolosha. You're watching Thunder Insider.
The Thunder is a perfect 5-0 at the Chesapeake Arena this playoff season, and Oklahoma City fans are quickly making a name for themselves as one of the best and loudest crowds across the NBA. In this week's Steel in the Mic, the Sports Animal's Mike Steele caught up with an NBA super fan who's seen hundreds of games across the league and gives us his take on OKC.
All right, you talk about a man who's styling. This is it right here. Tell me a little bit about, you've been around obviously to so many NBA arenas, seen all kinds of environments. How does the Oklahoma City environment stack up?
I'll tell you, and I tell everybody else, Oklahoma's number one when it comes to fan enthusiasm. There's no question about it.
It's just so fun. Everyone's always getting so into it, and it's just so loud and crazy all the time.
Great people of Oklahoma. They stand behind their teams and support them all the way.
What sets it apart, you think?
Well, the loudness, the intensity of the crowd, the fact that they're really into the game, everything about it.
We've heard the Thunder fans' playoff atmosphere is by far and away the best in the league. What do you think makes it that way?
I think it's just the just how loud we are. I mean, we're like a sixth man out there on the court. We're super loud, and the opposing team just has a hard time dealing with it.
The energy, it's just amazing. All the fans and, you know, everybody coming together and cheering them on, and it's great.
Just wild, crazy excitement. It's totally electrifying.
It's a great environment. It's a great setting. The team's great. The coaching staff's great. We love everything about it.
Now, if I want to get this look, where do I go to get this look?
Well, you have to go to Italy to find this.
I don't know if I have the budget, but I'd love to go.
Johnny Versace.
Thanks. Enjoy the game.
Thank you.
always, Stylin. And Jimmy Goldstein gives OKC his top vote. Very nice. Well, thanks again for joining us here at our Oklahoman studio for another special playoff edition of Thunder Insider presented by Integris Health. We'll see you again next week with plenty more on Thunder basketball.